Hello everyone. We are proceeding with the chain of fibroid uterus or leiomyomas. In last class, we discussed about the pathology, the definition, and further what are the types of the fibroids. So now moving on with the topic. Last time also I told that it is a huge topic, so we will be covering it in bits and pieces so that we can remember it very, very easily. So we will be discussing secondary changes. First of all, a case scenario, how you will be getting cases, how you will be getting questions. A 26 years old primi gravida with 28 weeks of pregnancy presents with complaints of abdominal pain. The earlier scan showed an intramural fibroid of 2 centimeters. The pain this time is not periodical and not associated with vaginal discharge. So write your presumptive diagnosis and management. How to read a question? This is important. The history itself tells you what they are talking about. So this is a patient who is pregnant, who is having a fibroid and is in the almost second end or third trimester of pregnancy, that means late pregnancy. And the pain which she is having is continuous abdominal pain, and it is not a labor pain because it is not periodical and no shove, no vaginal discharge. So there must be some change going on inside the fibroid which is creating the problem. Red degeneration of fibroid or carinous degeneration of fibroid is a very, very common degeneration which we get in pregnancy. So accordingly we will manage this case. It was just an example. Later on we will discuss more such cases, but from this I just want to say that when they are mentioning fibroid or pregnancy, think about degeneration. So secondary changes in fibroid, they could be of 6 types. Most common of them is degenerations. This is most common, least common. This is such an hierarchy, right? So degenerations are most common, then comes atrophy, necrosis, infection, vascular changes and sarcomatous changes. For all those candidates who are appearing for their UG exams or PG exams, you need to remember 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The names are important and then we will elaborate, but at least we will like make a mnemonic or something. Degeneration, atrophy, necrosis, infection, vascular changes and sarcomatous changes. Now what do you mean by degeneration? Degeneration means the cells, because we know that it is a monoclonal thing which is mostly cellular, it contains smooth muscles and connective tissue. So some changes start occurring and these cells or the connective tissue start degenerating. Degenerating occur as the tumor outgrows its blood supply. It generally occurs in huge fibroids because we know that the blood supply enters from the capsule. In the last lecture, I discussed that this is the fibroid with its whorled appearance, right? And the blood supply comes from the periphery through the pseudocapsule. I hope all of us remember pseudocapsule. So the center is always devoid of blood supply. Very less blood supply the center is having. So whenever the fibroid grows and it outgrows the blood supply, the changes of degeneration occur and they mainly start from the center. Now, what all 5 types of degeneration we will find? Hyaline, cystic, fatty, calcific and red. All of them are important, but hyaline and red are specially important from your exam point of view. First of all, hyaline degeneration. It is the most common. So if they will ask you the fibroid is having degeneration, so the most common degeneration is the hyaline degeneration, which is 65%. It is the most common type of degenerating, affecting all sizes except the tiny one, generally the large ones. The central part of the tumor, which is least vascular, is the common site. We know why, because it is devoid of blood supply. So the hyaline changes will take place. We remember our pathology, that there are changes, hyaline changes. What are they? The normal world appearance. Remember, white world, the cut section, the pathology. So the center part is replaced by hyaline structure. Naked eye examination on cut surface shows irregular homogeneous areas with loss of the whorl-like appearance. In the center, you will not find this whorl. You will find only homogeneous appearance, which is hyaline, and so this is the hyaline degeneration, and this is the most common degeneration. Cystic degeneration, it usually occurs following menopause and is common in the interstitial fibroids. Remember the lecture? This is the endometrium, this is the serosa, this is the myometrium. So the interstitial fibroid, which is inside the myometrium, following menopause, as the blood supply decreases and as the estrogenic environment decreases, it causes cystic degeneration. It is formed by the liquefaction. We need to form a cyst. What is cyst? Cyst is a collection of water. So, liquefaction of the areas with hyaline changes, not exactly water but a fluid. Out of them, 15% may show myxomatous degeneration. Myxomatous degeneration is generally degeneration of the connective tissue. The high level of metallic proteases, MMPs, in myxomatous degeneration. It occurs mainly in the central part of the myoma. It is common for all the myomas, and smooth muscle cells undergo myxomatous degeneration. Fatty degeneration. Most of the degenerations except for red and hyaline you will find in menopause, because as we know that the fibroids, they flourish in the estrogenic environment. Once there is menopause, there is no hormone, the degenerative changes start. Fatty degeneration usually found at or after menopause. Fat globules are deposited mainly in the muscle cells. So the muscle cells, they start going degeneration and they are replaced by fat globules, and it is called as fatty degeneration. Calcific degeneration, it is seen in 10% usually. 65% was of hyaline. It is very less common. This is the calcific degeneration, and it involves the subserous fibroids or small pedicle or myomas of postmenopausal women. Mostly those fibroids which were subserous or we were having a small pedicle, they undergo calcific degeneration. It is usually preceded by fatty degeneration. So in menopause, when there is less estrogen, then there was collection of fat. So initially there was fatty degeneration, and then later on there is deposition of calcium carbonate, right? Mostly it occurs in fibroids of postmenopausal women and those with small pedicle, subserous fibroids, where initially fat gets deposited and then there is precipitation of calcium carbonate or phosphate. Sometimes the whole of the fibroid, initially fatty degeneration, it becomes soft, but later on calcium carbonate, calcium phosphate, they get on deposited and it becomes just like a stone, hard. So it gives you the feeling of womb stone. Womb means uterus, so the uterus appears like a stone. This is exam question. Womb stone is because of calcific degeneration. Red degeneration or carnious degeneration. Carnious means red. So why is it red? In exam, you will mostly find the red degeneration of the fibroid. This is the most commonly asked question in the exam. It occurs in a large fibroid mainly during the second half of the pregnancy and the puerperium. 5 to 10%. What do you understand by puerperium? Most of you must be knowing what is puerperium. Puerperium is the time after the pregnancy ends and the postpartum period begins. It is called as the puerperium. So during puerperium, 5 to 10% cases, you will find the large fibroid mainly in the second half of the pregnancy and the puerperium, when there are the changes in the hormones, excessive estrogen and progesterone and decline in the hormones, you will find a red degeneration. The cause is not known, but because it is red, that means blood. So it may be vascular in origin. Infection does not play a part. So the case scenario which we were discussing was about the red degeneration, because the patient was pregnant and in the later half of the pregnancy. There is no infection, only the vascular changes, they cause this cairnous degeneration. Naked eye appearance of the tumor shows dark areas with cut section revealing raw beef appearance, often containing cystic spaces. But this raw beef appearance, that means extremely dark red color in pathology. Some vascular changes have occurred, so the fibroid generally increases in size, it becomes painful, and the cut section shows a raw beef appearance which is extremely dark red in color. So this is red degeneration or cairnous degeneration. The odor is fishy due to the accumulation of the fatty acids. Fatty acids also get accumulated. So red degeneration of fibroid is an important part of the degenerations of fibroid. Now with this we finish the degenerations part. Now we come across the atrophy part. Atrophy. What do you understand by atrophy? The size decreases. Atrophic changes occur following menopause due to the loss of support from estrogen. Fibroids are totally dependent upon estrogen. So when there is menopause, menopause means complete cessation of menses for complete 1 year. So for complete 1 year, there is no menses, there is no menstrual cycle, no ovarian cycle, less estrogen, less progesterone in the body. It causes the fibroid to shrink. There is reduction in the size of the tumor, and similar reduction also occurs following pregnancy enlargement. During pregnancy, as the uterus increases in size, the fibroid also increases in size, and sometimes it may be a red degeneration, so the size of the fibroid increases. But the size to decrease, we need to withdraw the estrogen, and the atrophic changes occur in menopause or after pregnancy. Necrosis. It is necrosis, no infection. Necrosis, circulatory inadequacy may lead to central necrosis. Obviously, because the central part, we remember, least blood supply. So everything will happen from this place. So central necrosis of the tumor. But when it is a pedunculated tumor, small pedicle, large fibroid, so the blood supply is not adequate. A submucous polyp or a subserous fibroid. This is the uterus. This is the endometrial cavity. If there is some submucous polyp which is like having a very small pedicle and it is a huge polyp coming down towards the os, so it may undergo necrosis because of the less blood supply. Or there is a subserous fibroid with a very, very thin pedicle. Sometimes it may become parasitic or wandering, but sometimes it may undergo necrosis because of the less blood supply. So either after menopause, or this is pedunculated subserous fibroid or a submucous polyp, it can undergo necrosis. Now comes infection. Why infection? When infection? When it is exposed to the outside environment, some infective agent may creep in and there may be infection. The infection gains access to the tumor through the thinned and sloughed surface epithelium. What does that mean? This is the uterus. Sometimes there is a submucous polyp which is protruding out from the cervix inside the vagina. Now, vagina is a portion which is open to the external environment, and because the pedicle is less, there can be necrotic changes inside. So the surface epithelium of this submucous polyp gets eroded. Now it is open for infection and it is in the external environment. So a submucous polyp may get infected. This usually happens following delivery or abortion. Of course, because during delivery or abortion or any such thing where the endometrium sheds, it is open to the external environment, the chances of sepsis are more. Intramural fibroid may also get infected following a delivery. During delivery, what happens? The whole thing is opened up and decidua sheds away, and the chances of bacterial invasion through the cervical canal are very, very common. So if there is some huge intramural fibroid with some necrotic margins, definitely it may get infected. So infections are mostly like preceded by necrosis, because the surface epithelium is thin and it is exposed to the external environment, either a submucous polyp or during delivery or abortion, it can happen. Vascular changes. Vascular changes means the vessels, telangiectasia, the dilatation of the vessels and dilatation of the lymphatic channels may also occur, and the cause is unknown. Due to some idiopathic reason, no one knows the lymphatic channels or the blood vessels, they may get dilated and there is nothing more to tell about it. Sarcomatous changes. This is the least common but the most dreaded one. Occurs only in 0.1% cases, very, very less. The leiomyoma can get converted into leiomyosarcoma. The usual type is leiomyosarcoma. So what we read about fibroid, it was the most common benign tumor. But if sarcomatous change occur, it will become malignant. How will we suspect that this fibroid can undergo a change of leiomyosarcoma, or this fibroid has already become a sarcoma? So, number one, recurrence of the fibroid polyp. Bar bar polyp banta ja raha hai. The more you are taking it out, again it is forming. Sudden enlargement of the fibroid. Sudden enlargement of fibroid can occur in cases of degeneration also, if there are some prerequisite factor which you can notice, for example pregnancy. But if other than that there is a sudden enlargement of the size, you find that there is some problem, it can be a sarcoma, or the fibroid presents with postmenopausal bleeding. The patient was already having menopause, she had not menses since last more than 1 year, and suddenly she says that I have started menstruating, there is spotting, and you find there is a fibroid which has increased in size, it could be sarcoma. So you should remember these three points: recurrence of the fibroidal polyp, sudden enlargement of the fibroid, or postmenopausal bleeding along with fibroid. These three points will increase the suspicion that there may be some sarcomatous change in this fibroid. With this, I finish off this in a very, very small video, that there are these changes which are the secondary changes in fibroid which you may notice, and once you get a case scenario like that, we will manage it accordingly, which we will be talking in the coming lectures. Thank you very much.